evening. It's good to be in Northamptonshire. I started off this morning out at Tower Bridge looking at Lermisham vehicles because I'm the roads minister, so I do that kind of stuff. And I went back to Parliament to do parliamentary questions. And I went out to Harwich on the Essex coast where I was doing my work as maritime minister. And I came back here. Now, I knew today I was going to be the presence of a powerful woman. But I didn't know it was going to be Hurricane Doris. I think I could have been blown here, actually, at one point where I got out of the car. And I was like a hurricane. So it's a really great pleasure to be here. You can imagine that I get asked to get involved in road schemes literally from the very northeast of Britain right down to the tip of the southwest. And I can't go to all of them. I take an interest in all of them, but I can't actually go to every single place where there's a road scheme, because we're engaged in road schemes across that whole of that territory. But I wanted to come tonight really for three reasons. Firstly, because the case that's been made for this road by Richard, I have to say, by Ian, and by Andrea, has been exceptional. They have made this case forcefully, coherently, powerfully, in a measured way, and they've done it because they don't have it much in matters to you. The second reason is because I'm well aware of how long this has gone on. I have a great friend who lives in Towcester, who's in the audience. He doesn't have to reveal himself, but oh, there he is! So I visited this town many times with Mike, and I know over all of those years it's been talked about, and I gather from what Andrew told me, what you've confirmed tonight, much longer than that too, by the way, just in case you thought that we were as old as we do, which we're not. So that was the second reason. I know this is a really long-standing issue for Towcester. I'm aware of the consequences of that issue. It's congestion through the main part of the town. It's all the effects that has on your quality of life. Sometimes it can take, as you know, to just get through Towcester, it can take an age, can't it? And you're travelling a very short distance indeed. And I know what that means for local people and for how they go about their everyday lives. Then you've got the issues of air quality, with all the congestion and the traffic and all the rest of it. So you need this road, and it's as simple as that. The third reason is because it's really important that ministers, politicians, the people you elect and speak for you, get involved in the nitty-gritty of these things. Let me share a secret with you. It's very easy as a minister not to do that, because obviously you have a team of civil servants, lots of experts who present all the information to you, and they give you options to choose from, they make the arguments. But actually, it's very important that ministers come out to hear what you've got to say. I'm going to have a question and answer session at the end. See the situation for themselves, engage with the people directly affected. So I have a very simple rule in politics. I've been MP for 20 years in Lincolnshire, where I should be finally returning tonight, but I can be blown far enough that way, to see my wife and children. I'd rather be with them, actually, but is that fair? We all rather be with their wife and children. But when I get back there, I will continue the simple rule that I've followed all my political career. I always think, if it's not good enough for me, it shouldn't be good enough for anybody else. So if I lived in Towcester, what would I want? What would I want for my children? What would I want for my family? What would I want for the people I care about? And when people come to me and say, John, we've got this issue with housing or roads or whatever it might be, I say, how would I feel if it was in my backyard? And if it's good enough for me, it's good enough for you. That's the way I see it. It's as simple as that. And that's the rule I've always applied in politics. I'm going to apply here tonight. I was told we were beginning to look at the Highways England, who are the people now responsible for these things, as you know, were beginning to look at this matter in 2017-18. Well, you know what that could mean. There's not a single person here that doesn't know. That could mean the very end of March 2018, these things never mean the beginning of 2017, do they? They always mean, when you hear that kind of date, the very end of the process. So what I'm going to commit to you to do tonight are these things. The first thing I'm going to do is to accelerate the delivery of this road. I know that you've got the arrangement with the developer where the development is going to fund part of the road and we're going to fund the other part. And it's really important to accelerate this process, that both of those elements work together. Because if one of those bits of the jigsaw, as it were, falls out of place, the picture won't be complete. So if we can get the developer into the right place, where they can, through the development of the housing, support their bit of the road, and Highways England can fund their bit of the road, and essentially this is the difference between the roundabouts at the two ends and the bit in the middle, which you're all familiar with, and we can ensure that's coordinated, we can accelerate this development. So the first thing I want to say to you is I'm going to accelerate the delivery. I'm going to drive the delivery forward, not at the end of 2018, I'm going to bring the whole process forward, and with Andrea's leadership and the work of the local partner, I'm now looking at ways in which we can do that following meetings we've already had. Secondly, the risk on the developer side is the developer will say, and you know, you can see why they might say this, we can't fund our bit until we've built and sold all the houses. And the risk of that is that you get to the last part of the sale of the houses, and that goes on and on and on, because developments usually take longer than they originally planned to. So we've got to make sure the developer funds their part of it up front. And that will mean, frankly, borrowing the money in order to fund the road, and then building the houses that are serviced by the road, not the other way around. So I'm going to sit down and look at the ways we can find the most effective way of them being able to borrow the funds so they can fund the road before the houses are all built and sold. If we have to rely on the houses all being built and sold, who knows when that might be. Maybe no ill will in that, it just won't necessarily work out in the way that people want it to. So I'm going to do that as well. The third thing we're going to do is to work with the County Council and accelerate for Northamptonshire County Council means setting out early what the County Council wants from the Roof Road as the body responsible for owning and maintaining it. Deciding who will be constructing the road or part of it, and agreeing that now, we can do this very quickly with Highways England. Because this will be what important, because in the end, the County Council, as the local Highways Authority, will have responsibility ultimately for this road. So until we settle with the County Council quite how that's going to work out, I don't want that to be a further delay. We won't be able to guarantee developing it quickly. So I want to organise a very urgent meeting with Highways England. I'll facilitate this personally, with Highways England County Council, just to sort out that process of them taking responsibility for the road. The way that these road schemes work, as you I'm sure know, is first of all a business case is made, and that's a duty of Highways England. They have to prove value for money. I have absolutely no doubt that will be proved. I suppose I hope not to say that, but I'm pretty confident, given the development, given the need, given and so on and so forth. But that has to be done formally. It can't be just me saying, oh yeah, great, it's value for money, you can bypass the formal process. There has to be a process. But that's the process I was describing at the beginning, but I don't want to start at the end of 2018. So I want to start that process, and I've already told Highways England this, straight away, so we can move to establishing that and starting the ball rolling for the development of the road. We've already done a lot of work. So for the past 12 months, we've been modelling how the pattern and level of traffic will change as a result of this road, and doing the necessary environment assessment as well. So we've done that work. There's a lot of spade work already being done. But I want to make sure that the other elements, the other statutory elements in the process, don't delay the delivery of the road any longer. Finally, acceleration means for all the parties involved putting into place a formal agreement as soon as possible to provide certainty. And when we've done that, that's getting the developer, Highways England and the County Council all into a place where we can make that formal agreement. I think, and I hope you agree, my team on the top and your local leader, Andrea, I think we should share that with you. And if you're prepared to have another meeting, or we can write whatever the way you want it, I think we should share that formal agreement, say this is how this has been signed and sealed, the deal is done, the various bits of the jigsaw I've described are now in place, and this is what's going to happen, and this is the period over which it's going to occur, and this is where the road will finally, how and where the road will finally be built. So you basically want certainty. You want certainty and you want speed. That's exactly what I would want in your position. What you don't want is prevarication and delay and obfuscation. I know that you feel you've had that, not for the last year or 5 years, but as we've already heard tonight, over decades, not years. So my job is to give you an absolute assurance that we will use every possible avenue, every possible tool at our disposal to put this road where it needs to be, in the way that you want it, to relieve local people of the congestion, of the safety doubts, of the poor air quality, of all the other things I know you're currently suffering from. The component parts that I've described, the pieces of the jigsaw, as I put it, will happen not next week, not next month, not next year. We will start this process following this meeting tomorrow. And tomorrow I will begin to put all of those things into place. And I'm doing that because of the leadership that you see alongside me, but also because it's the right thing to do. And back to my core principle in politics. It's good enough for me, it's good enough for you. If this was my village, my town, my family, I want what you want. And because you want it, I want it too, and I'm going to make it happen. So thank you very much for having me.
I do see a hand up. All right, in the right and the back, sir.
I've always wanted to say this. Yes, Minister. But it sounds very impressive. Quite heartening, in fact. But do you have any kind of estimate as to when work might start and when work might finish? Because how it gets to happen doesn't concern me. All I'm interested in is the result. Thank you.
Right. The when. Yes.
You know that. Thanks for the Yes Minister quote, by the way. I don't know if that makes you Sir Humphrey or what it makes me. There we are. I'm going to go down that road.
He's dead.
I'm Jim Packer, up there now. I think this is what I want to be absolutely straightforward with you, okay? So I'd like to feel that we can get this wrapped up, and I know Andrea and I have discussed this, so we can begin the physical process before 2020. That's where I'd like to be, isn't it? Roads take a while to build, as you know, and so we have to do all the kind of diligence about the detail of building them. But if I can get all these preliminary stages in place now, I'm pretty confident there'll be no further delay than that. Now, it does depend on getting that agreement in place, making sure the developer's got the money, making sure they've got their money to invest, making sure the county council's in place, making sure Highway England are ready to go on their early for money. But if those things can be done, I genuinely think they can be done, I see no reason for a further delay than that. I don't want to give you a date. So I give you a date and say this will start on, you know, sort of September 2019, and then it slips.
Near 3 years.
You'll feel I'm not being sorry.
Is it likely to be near 3 or 5 years or 1 year?
Yes, I think given what I've said tonight and the need to take those steps, I think we're thinking about developing this in that period, in that gap, in that 3 to 5 year period. I would like to feel, long before I stop visiting my friend in Towcester, I'll be driving on that road. And that's not in my old age, that's in my early middle age, and that's where I am now.
All right.
myself, I thank John and Andrea for coming tonight and holding this meeting. Certainly the bypass has been campaigned for actively in Towcester for at least 35 years. There were banners on the town hall when I came here in 1982. So, and you're the first minister that's really taken any interest. But for years, the town council used to produce statistics on the road, and I'm sure the department had someone employed permanently to shred that information when it arrived in London. So,
what's your question?
So thanks, but the question is, I'm rather confused by John's statement. If I understood you correctly, you did say that Persimmon were part funding the relief roads. Well, I've been involved with the 106 agreement from the very beginning. My understanding, unless you correct me, is that Persimmon's commitment is to build in the entire road, and therefore the 106 agreement covers that. So that's the first point.
All right, shall we just pause?
Yeah,
but can we get that answer?
Yeah. Shall I answer that? The truth is about the 106 agreement is that it is indeed the case that Persimmon has to deliver that road by the time they've built and sold the 1,017th home. Yes. So that is true. So what we're talking about here, as John quite rightly pointed out, that we don't know when that will be. None of us have any idea when that will be. And so therein lies the challenge for Towcester, is that we need the road tomorrow. And so the key issue here is, when can we get that road? And what John is very kindly doing here is offering to facilitate an arrangement whereby Persimmon, who agreed to deliver it early in return for support from Highways England to get the two roundabouts at either end built, which in effect, if you're looking at the finances of it, which as you know is my favourite topic always, is to bring forward the net present value of a pledge sometime never, is to do less but do it earlier. And that's effectively what Persimmon are offering to do in return for Highways England doing the other bit. Yeah. So you're right, but John's presented us exactly correctly.
You notice how all my friends are left sitting down, but I kind of feel that I've got to stand up because I'm not local yet, so I can't sit down. But the real point is that we're going the extra mile, really, to make this happen. So we're going the extra mile to make this happen. We were concerned that, I think I indicated this earlier, that when developers do developments of this kind, you know how it happens. They sell the houses, they build some more, they sell the houses, they build some more. This is the way developers typically fund it. When you hear of developments, people say there's going to be X number of houses. People assume they're all going to be at once, and they're all going to be sold fairly quickly. It just doesn't work like that. My real worry, and Andrea's worry was, that meant the road disappears into the ether until the very last house is sold. And so what we're trying to do is to say, rather than take that risk, let's work together with the developer to deliver an outcome that's in the public interest and for the public good by government coming together with you to make this happen more quickly.
Yeah. All right, just a brief further comment, then somebody else.
Well, this is really important because this comes to the nub of it. I mean, but what we've been pushing for is government loaning Persimmon the money up front and then presumably then repaying it. But aren't you suggesting that the money the government puts up front goes to Persimmon? Because obviously Towcester as a community, rather than government, is building the relief road. Because if the relief road didn't have to be built, Towcester would deserve and get a lot more in terms of community benefits via Section 106. Yes, they would, because that money that would be used for other infrastructure has to be used for the building of the road, which is a considerable sum.
All right, okay.
So for clarity, is it a loan repaid, or is it a subsidy to Persimmons to build the road sooner? And in which case, if that's the case, I think we do need to know the complete start and completion date.
Well, I'll repeat the exact words I used. I think it's fair to do that in the light of your question. I said, we will help the developer find the most effective way of doing this, and what I was referring to was, in the case of the developer, borrowing money for the road earlier than originally planned. So what I'm looking to try to do is to facilitate an arrangement where the developer can do this affordably. And that's not because, we have no vested interest in that, we simply want to get it done quickly for you. And we know that with the best will in the world, there's no suggestion of ill will here, with the best will in the world, under the current arrangement, this could get pushed further and further back because the house sales and the development simply might not happen in the pace originally anticipated. So government coming into this is, on Andrew's request really, and your local team actually, is to try and get this done more quickly.
Just to be very clear, without going into the ins and outs of it, this is not letting the developer off any of the Section 106, because I think that's the nub of your point.
Right, yeah. Okay, let's take another question over there from Lady.
Talk of money loan figures, is there currently actually a broad estimate for the cost of the road, including Persimmon section and the proposed for Highways England to fund?
Yes, that's exactly what I was describing in terms of the value for money exercise. I was in the Department of Transport before. I worked briefly in the Minister for Security for a year, or well, that brief actually, 18 months. Before that, I was in the Department of Transport a previous time as Minister. And when I was there, I established Highways England. There used to be a thing called the Highways Agency, we changed to Highways England. And the licence that set up Highways England, it was stipulated that when a road scheme takes place, they have to do exactly the kind of work you described, which is to and make an estimate of cost, taking all the elements into account, and then test that against value for money. And the reason for that was, so because everyone's, you know, the demands on road building are many and varied, and we wanted to test the viability of schemes in an empirical way, in a careful, independent, thoughtful way. But the trouble with that is it can take a long time. So the point I was making about accelerating that part of the process, the different points, the point the gentleman raised there, was to ensure that's done as soon as possible. So bring that forward. So we can get the estimate that you described, we can test it against value for money, which I said earlier, I frankly think is going to be fine, given all we said about housing congestion and local economic activity and the way the current arrangements are inhibiting the town. And then move to the next stage, which is then actually getting the plans forward to put it into place. So yes, that will happen, and I'm determined that it should happen as soon as possible, and that's why I said I'll start work tomorrow.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just on the point you just made, Andrea, the 106 agreement is not going to help pay for this road. Is that correct?
Yes,
it's
it is.
Going
it
to
is.
Come to the tax.
It is. No, the Section 106 agreement will help pay for this road. I mean, the issue
why?
Is that...
And I ask why, because the builders would have had to build this road anyway to get in and out and to build their houses.
No, that's not. The Section 106 agreement says that the road must be delivered by the time the 1,017th house is built and sold. So that means 1,017 houses are built and sold before the road's delivered. And the problem with that is that then you don't know when that will be. There's no date on that. And a house builder might build 200 houses a year or 50 houses a year. You just don't know. So what we're seeking to do here is not to let the developer off any element of their 106 contribution, but simply to say that we will help them, that John is coming here to say he is going to help them to put this programme together so that the road can be delivered much earlier.
Can we just move on for a moment, right?
I'm rather confused because I thought there was more than one developer involved and there's 2,750 houses, so am I wrong in thinking that there is other developers involved?
Yeah. So Persimmon is the one, sorry? Yeah, Persimmon is 90% of the development, so it's Persimmon and Bloor, and there are more houses, but the actual agreement in the 106 is that it's the 1,017th house that then the road gets delivered. So it's true to say that the further houses beyond that would have the benefit of the relief road.
All right, let's go to the lady in front row, please.
Thank you. Can you confirm that the road that's going to be delivered is going to be able to take all of the heavy goods vehicles out of Towcester? And that we can then de-trunk the high streets for safety reasons?
Well, that's why I focused on safety, air quality and congestion. Because I know those are the three things that people have campaigned about for so long. And that's, of course, particularly exacerbated by the heavy vehicles you're describing. So one of the things I'm determined to do to make sure the road we build not only takes account of the existing traffic needs, but takes account of likely future traffic needs for two reasons. One, of course, because the new houses will add to the traffic demand, because there'll be people with cars and vehicles travelling to and from those houses, but also because we know what projected increased traffic demand looks like. One of the things that my department does is try to look forward to where traffic is likely to be in 5 and 10, 15 and more years' time. So the road we build has got to be fit for purpose to relieve the problems you describe, but also to anticipate likely demand. And I can assure you that's very much part of the process that I was describing we're now going to embark upon.
So you can de-trunk the...
So specifically in answer to that, I've looked into that, and that decision hasn't been taken yet. I've said, I think Towcester people would very much want that to be the case. I mean, if I can just say, when I first moved here in 2007, my little boy at the time was about 6 years old, and he dropped his bouncy ball in the road just next to the town hall, leant out to catch it, and I grabbed him by the hair as a juggernaut went sort of howling past. I mean, it's ridiculous, as we know, it's absolutely ridiculous. So I've certainly made that point, and the response has been they are absolutely open to it, i.e. very warm to the suggestion, but they haven't taken the decision yet. But it'll be something, it'll probably be the next part of our campaign, is because obviously, as with all of these things, not everybody has the same opinion, but I think on that we will be unanimous that everyone thinks it should be
just brief.
The only thing is, if that isn't what happens, all of the cars will go around the relief road to avoid the congestion in the town. The lorries will still want to take the shortest route through.
It's not the de-trunking, it's actually the weight restriction. So it may well be that remains the A5, but that there's a weight restriction on it. And so that would be another way of doing it. So all I'm saying is, they absolutely get the problem and are determined to solve it, but it's a question of how, not
okay,
not
lady behind you.
The following on from that, you did talk about traffic surveys having been done. Has anybody taken into account the number of times the M1 blocks up? Yeah. We live on the south side of Towcester, and I would estimate it's on average once a week
for a whole
year. How the traffic comes through Towcester. So we find that it's a stairstep from 5 miles south of Towcester all the way through Towcester. Now, is the new ring road or relief road going to be able to cope with that? Because I think that the M1, you know, for whatever reasons, there are more and more accidents occurring. And the moment that happens, it goes off the side. So just very quickly, a weight restriction. We were in Burford the other day. Now, I don't know whether anybody's been to Burford, but Burford has only the main street. It has a weight restriction, both ends of it, but there are heavy lorries just going straight through the middle.
Well, that's I'll deal with the 2 point. You've got Manchester cleverly and subtly slipped to a question. I got past the chairman as well. She was very strict. Let me deal with the second question for the sake of entertainment. Let me deal with the second question first, so we change the order. This is very much a local matter, and I don't want to tread on local territory, because this is for my colleagues on the left. But my experience of weight restrictions is you have to have them, then you have to enforce them. And there's always a challenge on enforcement. So you're absolutely right to raise it. And I know that colleagues on the left will have heard that. I've been doing this in my own constituency and so on and so forth, as you can imagine, over the years. On your first point, the government are very conscious of the need to improve the main arterial roads. And I put in place the road investment strategy, which is... I know this sounds like a political speech, so forgive me, but it is the most serious piece of road investment strategic work for general since the 1970s. So we have a national plan, which we call RIS 1, Road Investment Strategy 1, not hard to work out, which is about improving roads across the country. We're now looking at our next road investment strategy, which is RIS 2, for the post-2020 work, which will take us on then 2020s and 30s. The reason this is significant is, I don't want to bore you about it, but it's specific to these two reasons. Firstly, because governments are not that good at thinking strategically. We're both government ministers, and we know that in a democratic political system, the imperative in what's happened in a five-year cycle, you know why, don't you? Mm-hmm. We have to reapply for our jobs every 5 years. So that tends to mean that governments think insufficiently about long-term investment. And that impinges on infrastructural decisions, actually. It's true in all democratic political systems, including ours. So over the years, governments have tended to allocate funding in a quite piecemeal fashion. They dealt with things that gave a return over 5 years. This road investment strategy is looking very long term. I'm plotting developments over 5, 10, 15, 20, 30 years, building things that will probably last 50, 70, 100 years. And the second really important thing is we've put money behind it. So we've committed funding to that investment strategy, another thing government doesn't often do. So I am proud that we're doing that work on those main arterial roads, because the work we do on those main arterial roads has a really big knock-on effect, exactly as you describe it, on all the roads around. And when we developed the RIS, the Road Investment Strategy, one of the points I made, one of my officials has just joined us at the back of the room and he will remember this, is we must take account of the effect on all of those other roads in counties across Britain of what we do on those main arterial routes. There's no point having great motorways if you don't understand that all the roads that feed and serve them are affected by whether those motorways are running and working and efficient. So I completely agree with your point. Sorry to give you such a long answer, but this is a cerebral audience and they deserve a sensible answer.
Well, and also, if you're happy to go on till about 20 to 9, extend the meeting by 10 minutes because I'm
happy to go on as long as you want.
Well, no, I think we'll call a halt then.
Yesterday, yet another business closed its doors in Towcester. How many more are we going to suffer?
Is this to do with the roads you're talking about? It's about the roads. Yes, we do know about businesses, and that is
another one's closed on Watling Street. You know, the main street is getting virtually empty.
So what is your question in relation to the road?
What is the government going to do to help the local businesses?
Well, I think the Chancellor is going to be saying things in his budget, but that isn't to do with the road, so I'm going to go to somebody else because that's what we're talking about tonight. Yes,
ma'am. Basically, we're talking of the road not being completed probably for 8 to 10 years. That 8 to 10 years being where Persimmon are building approximately 240 to 250 houses a year, according to the first phases that have been published. Now, I personally, I live on Highfields. That is a very well-known rat run for anybody in a car and a not too big lorry to take from coming up.
So what's your question, please?
My question is, what sort of guarantees are there going to be to stop building Persimmon lorries from coming up that road at great pace, which the Red Road lorries did, damaging quite a few of the trees and impacting on the local residents on that road under Springfield Highfields?
This is largely a local question, but I think I want to pick up one point there. When we reached the agreement with the developer, which I said that we would share with you if you remember, I think we do need to explore, and I hope colleagues will agree, some of the issues about what's going to happen during construction. This is certainly something the County Council will have already done, and will happily, I know you would have done this, Ian. Ian may want to comment. Because of course you're right, that there's the issue about the completion of the road, there's the issue about the completion of the housing, the issue in between. Now, the reason I said the County Council are so vital is that part of that agreement has to be about the County Council's engagement and involvement, as well as the road investment, as well as Highways England and the developer. And much more expertise than I've got about.
The existing planning commission does have what's called a traffic management plan with it, which will dictate to Persimmon where the trucks shouldn't be going.
But had the road gone in first with the associated infrastructure, that would actually have perhaps negated any problems in advance.
Doing it back
to front is going to create a lot of local problems.
I'm not going to disagree with you that the ideal would be you put the road in first and then you would follow it, but we have to deal with the art of the possible rather than the ideal. I think all of us would say not to put the road in those houses later. The realities of funding are that they'll happen together. What we're attempting to do is to get government help to bring that forward by a significant number of years. But either way, and on your figures, you said it was 250 a year, and I think that's optimistic. I think more like 150 is probably...
On the
I think we've gone through that.
Well, they're totally different, but the 1016 trigger will always still will always still pull in, so even if you got the 250, it would still be 4 years.
Can I just add, though, you said you think it'll be 8 to 10 years. The whole purpose of this evening is to make it 4 to 5 maximum, not 8 to 10. That's the whole purpose of this evening. Is you're right, 8 to 10 could well be or more if we leave things the way they are. And the reason John is here is we're going to have an absolute real effort to get this. I mean, I've said by 2020, if we absolutely had a completely fair wind, we don't find any Roman ruins, there's no bats, there's no problems with the cars we purchased, blah, 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 then there's half a chance that 2020 could be achievable if we get the package in place and so on. And that's what John's committing to doing. And the reason he's not putting a date on it is not to be difficult, but simply to reflect that even as he promises to start on it tomorrow, we won't do that. There's still going to be a time period to do the approvals and then to actually build it.
Can we put that very plainly as the Roads Minister? I think your MP has argued the case very forcefully there, but I wanted it as plainly as this. My fear was that we'd be talking about this in a meeting like this in 10 years' time. My absolute determination is we won't, because it'll be done.
Right, okay, just a brief question.
I put my hat on as the local county councillor for Towcester. And I think that I do welcome, you know, the actions that you're taking. And I do welcome that your acknowledgement that you need to work in partnership with others. I think you missed a trick slightly tonight, because my discussions with the officers at the County Council, they knew nothing about tonight, and they would have actually liked to have been here, because they could have contributed. But on a more serious note, that's not...
Can you come to a question, Margaret?
The question is, you talked about the detrunking of the A5 coming through Towcester. I had the pleasure today of sitting through the County Council's budget setting, and I think everybody in the room acknowledges that the County Council is virtually bankrupt.
What's the question?
The question is, if you're going to ask the County Council to take over the maintenance of the A5 through Towcester, will government be paying them to do that? Because otherwise they won't agree to it.
Right, okay, you would like to...
I think that those are largely political points you're making there, Chris, and the truth is that, as I explained to this lady's question, it's not that the County Council are going to, that Highways England are going to detrunk the road. There may well be a weight restriction with enforcement. Those things are yet to be decided and discussed, but the fact is that Towcester deserves to get the relief road early, and that's what we're really focused on here tonight.
Okay, we'll have two more questions, I think. Your hand up for a while.
Oh, yeah.
I will look to you in a minute, sir. Let's go to this lady first.
Sounds like the kind of question that you get to enter the Chinese civil service, you know, almost impossible to answer, at least to say if you wanted to try to join the Chinese civil service during the imperial years, the first question was write all you know, and I'm not sure I could do that either. Essentially, this is a road that takes pressure off the centre of Towcester, that allows people to travel around the town rather than through it. So yes, of course it provides relief, and it bypasses the town. So I'm afraid to say that.
All right, since we...
I had a little road up there, so now this evening's coming along. The A5 goes from London to Holyhead, about 300 miles. Yes. So this is the only town of this size that hasn't got a bypass on the whole of the A5. Yeah. That shows the urgency of this.
Yeah.
Now I'm concerned about the type of relief road. We need a bypass. This relief road, if you look at the plan, it's got 7 miles on it. How long can heavy transport stay for a road? 7 miles on it. It's purely to feed.
Oh, all right, okay, you've made the point.
It has 4, not 7. But very specifically, specifically, if you talk to Brackley, they have a dual carriageway bypass, the A43, and residents of Brackley feel it killed the town because nobody, you don't get any passing traffic. So the idea of a relief road is that you would then be able to divert heavy traffic onto that and people who don't want to come to town, but that you wouldn't actually kill the town centre. There is a balance, actually, and I know it's been something where people have very varied views on this, but essentially that's the thinking behind a relief road, is you don't destroy the town centre itself.
Catherine Morris.
That you would be looking for the road in the planning stages to anticipate the traffic flow, so the traffic leads. What flexibility is there in funding, land, etc., to make sure that that happens?
The process that we go through in analysing those kind of needs, which is obviously a process that my officials go through, looks at all the things you described. So it would certainly look at the character of the road, the design of the road, and the way you describe it. It would project the current traffic trends. It would look at local economic and housing growth, and the effect that might have on demand. It would look, following the lady over there's question, other roads in the locality and the effect they might have on this road. So we would take into account a whole series of criteria to make a judgment about the suitability and appropriateness of this road. That would be done not as a matter of opinion, but as a matter of fact. It's quite an empirical process.
But so what can you change from a practical viewpoint? I've never built a road, but what can you do if forecast traffic flow is a lot higher because there are many developments in the area? What can you do?
Well, over time, of course, that's what happens, because if you think about almost every road that's been built, including Watling Street, which was built by the Romans, as you well know, roads change over time. But what you have to do is use the kind of factors I described to anticipate as much as you possibly and reasonably can. And that has to be a thorough process, it has to be a comprehensive process, and it has to be an independent process. And that's what my officials will go about in the case of this road.
All right, we'll take one more question before I get them to sum up. All right, Sue, it's for you.
Mr. Redoper, is it going to be a dual carriageway or not?
We'll certainly look at that in the context that I just described. So we'll look at the character. I talked earlier about the design of the road. What kind of road do we need to build in order to deal with the things I described as part of the process I set out?
Okay.
No, I can't anticipate that.
All right, well, thank you. That's
point of clarification, please, Mr. Chairman, from something Mrs. Vedstrom said.
What clarification do you want?
Yeah. I may have misunderstood you, Andrew. Did you say that the reason that Towcester won't have a bypass is to protect what's left of its sort of dying business community in the town centre?
No, not at all. No, as you'll know, the plan for the relief road at the moment is that it is a single road around the town. And what I was saying is that there are very mixed views, and what Brackley residents say about the existence of their bypass is that it led to a complete destruction of any passing traffic through the town, and it means that Brackley's town centre is not as thriving as Towcester's town centre, notwithstanding your points that somebody's point that shops are closing. But nevertheless, as the Minister has just said, an evaluation will be firmed up of exactly what the need is. But of course, you know, if it were to change from the current plan, then that might well slow things down. And you know, as we all know, roads evolve over time. Single carriageways become dual carriageways over time. And certainly for me, because the plan is for a single carriageway, I just want to get it built. I think a road is better than no road. And I think that the perfect is enemy of the good and all those cliches. So I'm just really keen that we get this road built as soon as we possibly can.
Okay, well, we've had plenty of... hang on a second. We've had ample time for questions. I hope you will agree. So sorry, those of you who haven't had a chance to ask, but I hope points that you wanted raised have been. Minister, would you like to say a few
Yes, I'd
words?
Like to say three things. Can I just amplify on your behalf, thanks to Ian, Richard, brilliantly chaired, by the way, I've been in many meetings in my life, and I know I've had very few chaired with that kind of style of club. So I'd like to thank Richard, Ian, and Andrew for the work they've put into this. It really is appreciated on your behalf. Thank you for coming and say what a delight it's been. It really is important for ministers to come out and meet the people whose decisions they affect. So thank you very much for what you've done. I'm going to, I hope, entertain you a little further. I thought when I came here about John Clare, the great Northamptonshire poet, I don't know how many of you are fans of poetry, but Clare was the great Northamptonshire poet. And John Clare said, the best way to avoid a bad action is by doing a good one. There is no difficulty in the world like that of trying to do nothing. And in the case of this road, we are going to do a good action. I'm not just yes minister, I'm the minister that likes to say yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John, for coming to Towcester and giving us encouragement that this road is on the agenda and at the forefront of what's going on in London with you. And there are a large number of people who've made this possible, and I wish to place on record my thanks to them all. Firstly, as I've said to you, John, and your ministerial team and your civil servants, because we've done as much work, our officers and councils, with your team as we've done face to face. To you, Andrea, and again, your office, Tommy, Luke, and your team, I'm grateful to all their work. I'm also grateful to Catherine, sitting in the front row here, and her team at Teabag, who keep us all honest, and brings me up from time to time to get regular progress reports. And can I thank all the Towcester councillors, both at SNC and the Towcester Town Council, for all your efforts, and again, in that keeping us honest and keeping on the pressure. To Richard Oldroyd and his team at Persimmon for all their work so far in modelling and remodelling and what-ifing and various things that we've gone through in order to get this far. And to you all, thank you all for your attendance tonight, for coming out in the middle of the storm. I am most grateful. And finally, Richard, as John has already said, thank you, Mr. Chairman, for having the rather risky job of taking on chairing any public meeting. So, ladies and gentlemen, I wish you all a safe home, and thank you once again.
Yeah, just as you do out.